any action when you hear the alarm message.
When they wanted to, we could find them a cheaper alternative to what it is that they're doing. We own buildings, the command authority own buildings, you own buildings, councils own buildings. There's lots of partners that we could ask to work with us. They
attention please, attention please.
At all.
We have an emergency within the building.
Is
please
exactly
leave
what
by the nearest available exit.
They can go to the Prime Minister and say, look at our department, we've saved 10 bob. But, big picture wise,
attention please, attention please.
Hundreds
we
of
have an emergency within the building.
And it's that silo mentality, and I saw it while I was down there, where one department would try and save somebody with the knock-on consequences being
attention, please.
What the
attention, please.
In cost.
An incident has been reported
within
the building.
Away, at least
please
they did
wait
try
for further
the
announcements.
And we need to get back to that where government departments actually speak to each other. And it's
attention,
not
please.
Who saved
attention,
the most money
please.
For their individual departments.
The fire alarm test is now complete.
On the ambition to be the most digitally connected.
Thank you for your cooperation.
You have to be ambitious, don't you? You have to set stretching targets. What's the point of saying we want to be one of the most digitally connected, the top six digitally connected city regions in the whole country? Well, there are only six of us, so you've got a good chance, haven't you? But you know what I mean? You have to aim for something really that's stretching. And getting it on the agenda, because people then start to formulate their thought processes around digital connection. So we've got a report, it will be available to you. I think it's probably due at the end of June, which is possibly July, but it's about digital connectivity in its widest sense, but it's about inclusiveness. I know that's a big thing for you, you want to become digitally inclusive as well. So we're doing a whole piece of work on that. Believe it or not, again, we're leading the country. The government's interested in what we're doing. We have the opportunity of bidding in for something called fiber network funding. There's a load of things and stuff. We're not just doing these things because we think it's nice. We're doing these things because we want to take the whole city region forward, but also because there are national pots which we can the city region to hopefully be able to access. And on the apprenticeship levy, the bane of my life. People will know my background as an apprentice myself, but I ended up with the Learning Skills Council. I managed staff who had the contracts for all of the major institutions in the built about Merseyside as it was then, but the city region. I know how funding frameworks work. I know what you can do if you get access to cocktails of funding. I know how to put them things together. During the attack on Westminster, I used that opportunity because we were locked down, the whole Commons was locked down. It was about 7 hours that we were stuck in there. And being a typical scouser, I thought, I'm not just going to waste my time here while other people were playing Candy Crush or whatever. So I went over and lobbied government. I spoke to Justin Greening, who was the Secretary of State at the time. I forecast that there would be a massive underspend. The underspend currently stands at 1.28 billion. The apprenticeship starts figures have dropped off a cliff in the first two quarters of this year. We're 26% down in our city region. That's a quarter of people now who have been denied opportunities for apprenticeships that would have happened last year. It's absolutely, but it's not hindsight. And the reason is because I have a series of letters that I wrote to the department education forecasting exactly what was going to happen, and I said to two secretaries of state now, work with us, we will design a programme, you can have the I'm aware that this is getting filmed you can have the credit for the government, right? If it's successful, we'll take the state, it's not, but we knew it's going to be successful. We will design programmes over and above what currently that we have, where there's some flexibility around the type of apprenticeship that we, both the level that we pitch it at, so on degree level apprenticeships, but the level, but also the occupational sectors. There are a number of areas within the city region where businesses tell me they cannot get people with the right skills, and that's because we're not training them, we don't have the capacity to train them. We could develop that? And who is the ultimate beneficiary? UK PLC and business. And it's businesses' money, private, public sector, who have put this into a pot. That pot is not being used for what it was designed to do. They can use Liverpool City Music as a pilot scheme, and we could deliver all those things. Our young people would get the benefit of the training, our businesses would get people that they want. We would be able to demonstrate that we're able to do these programs, because they always look at Manchester and elsewhere. We can do them here. It's a win-win-win, and the government can claim the targets. There's nothing in that that people wouldn't agree with. DfE are the worst government departments to work with. We thought DWP were. DfE are the worst government department. Followed very closely by DWP, but certainly for the stuff that we've done, DfE just failed to even engage with us. And write letters back saying we'll wait to see what the outcomes are of the policies that were introduced before we can do anything to change it. And you think, well, that's really good. We know it's failing, so we'll wait till it fails a little bit more and then we'll do something to address it. It's a nonsense. I was hoping to see the Prime Minister in a few months' time, in June, on a one-to-one. It was the one issue to the top of the agenda that I was going to flag him to. It looks now that that might not be available because of understanding the tensions in the world and Brexit and stuff. But if I do get the chance, believe me, that's the first thing that I'll be fighting out on.
Just want to ask you something a little about university debt, because it's going to have a big impact on our people on the other side. The main focus that I brought this question about is around the 800 families who are going to be getting support over the next coming months, etc. And to actually develop that, you've got to provide a targeted approach, wrapping around that, as you said. We've been doing some work with the task and finish group around universal credit. And what's going to be happening is going to be a tsunami in terms of the numbers across Merseyside in terms of the impact. And that impact is going to be both on families and individuals. Now, for me, one of the key sort of recommendations has been around partnership. And it links into the question earlier around silo mentality and having a joined up approach. So what I'm asking is, if you're going to put interventions in, how can the Office of the Mayor, both from, if you like, a national level, in terms of catching the eye of government, in terms of addressing the issue of joining the interventions in place, because the DWP didn't actually come to our meeting. We were too busy. He did give us a note of some length, but actually to have them there wasn't really a good look. So I'm asking, can we start from a national level up at the DWP in terms of how they're going to engage, but also on a local level, how the Office of the Mayor, given some of the recommendations we've made and the tsunami that's going to happen, how can we engage on a local level to join things up for those people who are going to be involved now and in the future of some of the horror stories that we're hearing from the universal credit. So, could you give us some light on that, please?
I don't know whether you want to take them together or individual. So you'll know that the process that we have to quite rightly abide by, because it's our constitutional position, is that any of these issues have to come through the leaders. Have to be agreed by the leaders, and it's not for me, and I genuinely do believe this thing is quite valid. It's not for me just to decide on what bits I can plug up here. We have to join ourselves up. We can't always be looking at other people who are joined up and putting the finger at them if we don't get our act together. So we have to do it through that route, and And I think this is the sort of thing that if it did come via the leavers, we could have some influence. Not massively, it'd be, you know, probably just around the edges, but we can make a difference because I'm with you. I think the rollout of the universal credit, I agree, I think it's a tsunami, I think they're going to be huge aftershocks. It's the detriment on individuals' lives, isn't it? Maybe that we're concerned about, not just processes. It's people who are put into debt, into depression, into all sorts of mental health issues as a result of this failed pilot being rolled out further. I've fought as an MP and said, until you get all of the issues around universal credit sorted out, don't be taking it any further. And of course, those warnings went unheeded as they created chaos in people's lives. So I think there is the possibility that we can do something on it. We don't administer these sort of things. Just say about DfE, closely followed by DWP. DWP, as I say, we're in London, and said, you know, we'd be happy to look at things and all that. You talk the talk, but you don't walk the walk, and I think it'd be difficult to engage unless it really is. We get our act together and then possibly try and get the six metro mayors to take this up as one issue, one voice, because it doesn't just affect here, it's going to affect everybody.
Thanks, Steve. I just want to put it out there because it's an issue, and I accept, no, I know what you're saying, but it's on the agenda that we can have some conversations with others.
Yeah, thank you,
Councillor
Brennan. I see Councillor Thomas, Councillor Wainwright, Councillor Sullivan. We'll do individual questions if you speak. That's all right, just carry on the way we've been so far. Councillor Thomas.
Thank you, Chair. First of all, Steve, I'd just like to congratulate you on your outstanding accomplishments thus far. You've clearly worked diligently and hard to promote the Liverpool brand. I look forward to seeing further investments in the city region. It's great that the city region has a metro mayor who's clearly very ambitious. And I'd like to also commend all the efforts of the combined authority, with obviously being a great team. My question, in fact it's more of a suggestion for you, is have you thought about an incentive for employers in the form of a sort of award system for employing people from diverse backgrounds to try and discourage discrimination?
We are, through the Fairness and Social Justice Advisory Committee, which you know, all about. We are in the process of working with Lynn Collins to draw an employment charter that will be an exemplar in the whole country. We've not only got this body, which is the first of its kind, it's not a commission because it doesn't meet, make recommendations and then disappear. This is a standard body that will be there as long as I'm the metro mayor. And a great forum, I think, for these sorts of ideas. So our employment charter will include things like this. And we're looking at a scheme whereby we can, for those employers who are exemplars, they can get a gold, but for those who are aiming for it, but there are things that they can't do at that time, silver and bronze, you know what I mean, to really get this out there. And we want to lead by example. So, as you know, all of our policies here are leading in the whole country in regard to engagement with not just people disabilities, but people with the ape characteristics, the protected characteristics, and all that way, way beyond what you statutorily have to do, you're forced to do. We go way beyond that, and I want to continue that. So, happy for you to put any ideas to Lynn, and Lynn will use that. I know she will really to promote best practice in the country. As a politician, you'll know this, I don't normally get compliments. We are at an early stage of the development of the Combined Authority. And you're right, it is a team. And genuinely, I said this, you know, when we walked in and there wasn't a lot of capacity here. I said I'd love for somebody to do, perhaps a research student or somebody, to look at what has happened to the Liverpool City meeting and the other five, all of whom had some capacity, and especially Greater Manchester, who had all the capacity but really little flexibility. We had so much flexibility and little capacity. But to see which of those two ends of the spectrum in the long run bears more fruit. And I think what we're developing here, the people that we've attracted from the very top of the public and private sector to go into the city region, I think we'll be miles ahead of the game. It's going to take years, of course, because you have to get all of those things and the foundations laid. We've done all of that hard work over the last 12, 11 months. Let's see what happens in the future. But it's nice for somebody to recognise that we are really trying to make a huge difference to the people that we represent.
Thank you, Steve. Thank you, Councillor. Thank you, Councillor Thomas. Councillor
Wright. Yeah, I just wanted to pick up on something earlier. See a bunch of recommendations coming forward from this group of panel that were taken up from the topic group that we have. Some of them that you can't do direct, but I must urge you to try and push these forward with central government, because we hope that they will make a difference to those people on universal credit, those who suffer from the effects of universal credit. I also wanted to mention or ask a question on the apprenticeships. We spoke to Siobhan, it must have been about 2 years ago then, with regards to apprenticeships, again through the topic group. We realised that most of the companies who had to pay a levy are going to use that internally first, and you sit your egg adverts on the radios all the time about, you know, training your staff and using your own levy. We know that it's going to probably take a couple of years before it starts getting out to the wider community and taking apprenticeships off outside. But the work that the hub was doing at that time, the apprenticeship hub was doing at that time, fantastic work, but it was realised that it was vastly under the resources were not as good as what could be. Can we have some assurance from you that those resources will be ploughed into the apprenticeship budget so we can do the work that it's good at doing and bringing everybody together from all our partnerships so that we can get this firmly established and get it really up and running? Because Siobhan and her team do a fantastic job, and we need that hub there to actually concentrate on what it is.
Thanks, Chair. I think what you're saying, Kevin, and what Tony was both saying as well, is about soft powers as a mental mayor. And there are huge convener powers, soft powers, so much so that there was a big debate when we met as the six metro mayors with Sadiq on the M7. So metro mayors seven. So the M7 met, and Sadiq, I think, had a proportion, was it 90-10? Remember? I think something like that, of soft power to actual power. So he wields huge power, but it's not constitutional power, it's not written down anywhere, it's not a part of an agreement with government. And we need to do that, but where Sadiq can do it a bit more independently is his role is recognised because it's been developed now for 17, 18 years, and it now. Whereas this role is brand new, and we have to be sensitive to the six district leaders and cognizant that we need to go through that sausage machine first before we get the agreement whereby then I can go forward. And that's what I was trying to say to Tony before. If the leaders come forward with it, even though it's not in our constitution, it's not in our demotion agreement, I've told this before, proud Scouser, I believe that we learn to read between the lines before we read words. It doesn't say anywhere in our constitution or our devolution agreement we can't do anything. Therefore, let's push the envelope, let's see whether we can get the government to respond to these issues.
Thank you, Councillor.
So I'm happy to do it, and I'll write to anybody and go down and speak to anybody in Whitehall and Westminster if we get a political agreement first. On apprenticeships, it's a massive issue for us, and it's huge, but it is a genuine opportunity for us as well. We know this money is there, we know that there's availability for all these sort of things. So what have we done locally? Well, again, yeah, you can get all the documentation for this, about the Skills Commission. We've had an employer survey, so we need an evidence-based approach to what it is that we're doing. The appointment of Kirsty. Kirsty used to work in what's called the local government unit, and that was about skills and apprenticeships as well, so she's bringing all this experience in. The one thing that we have to do differently is that we have to look at what we need to change in the system. If we carry on doing what we're doing, then we will get some sort of results. And whilst that's, you know, we're not massively behind anywhere else, we need to be pioneering stuff. We need to get the vanguard of what these opportunities are. We need to be looking at setting the bar at a very, very high level. So I want to change, I want to make a step change. I want to be the area where apprenticeships are gold standard, because unfortunately the plan was destroyed by the Tories. I sat in the House of Commons while I was talking about apprenticeships being 17 weeks. That is not an apprenticeship. That destroys trust in what it is that we're trying to achieve. I want to get back to gold standard and then to degree level. I went to John Moores University and they are doing level 6 in civil engineering and construction, MBQ level 6. Anybody who's trying to do an MBQ level 4 or 5, you'll understand that these aren't Mickey Mouse qualifications. MBQ level 6, and then the hope to go to 7, that's where we need to get to. Give kids a progression. I think we'd all agree, wouldn't we? Rather than going through academia where you come out with a £40,000-£50,000 millstone around your neck of debt, student debt, can have an apprenticeship where you get a similar sort of qualification and you get paid. You actually get paid, so you're not accruing the debt, you get paid, and you're learning not just the qualification but the company ethos. So that will hopefully give you the best chance for when the job becomes available, if it's an advertised job, to walk straight into it. You know, I think there are many different ways into the world of work. Lots of people that we represent, this is a fantastic opportunity for me to do everything that we can. We can't continue to do what we do. As that said, the definition of insanity is do what you've always done, thinking that's going to provide different results. It won't. We need to do things differently. And I'm one of those who's more than happy to look at how we can make those changes happen in our area.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And then I've got one final question, I think, Councillor Sullivan.
Thank you. You certainly lived in my spirits, Steve. I'll tell you 2 weeks before the local elections. Mine's a very simple question. I'm still amazed that there was no capacity when the devolution deal was done. There was no capacity index from your office. Now, we're all aware, sitting around this chamber, your office responded this year from the 6 boroughs. My question is, how are we going to fund your office from next year going forward so it's sustainable? How are we going to do it? There's only 2 ways, I think, unless you're going to tell me different, Steve. One is to put a precept on the council tax. The other one is to put a levy on the 6 boroughs. So what's it going to be? Thanks, Chair. Thanks, Steve.
The start point for all this is that I'm not saying that anybody really knew what it was that we were getting into at the very beginning. It is a complicated thing. We are the most centralised political democracy in the whole world, and we have that geographic, economic, unbalanced economy because of everything being focused in London. So everybody thinks that the English is a really good idea. They should do, because it is. And then it is about how you put structures in place and then fund them, isn't it? We wanted to put structures in place, but really didn't have a sustainable model. But what we had was was £30 million, of which 75% of it was capital, 25% of it was revenue. And we thought the revenue was to would help us to run 7.5 million quid. That was running combined authority, but 7.5 million quid. My budget was 6.2 million this year, so 7.5 is plenty. The government, hidden in the SI and the orders from Parliament, say that there's an expectation that the money that they give, the 30 million again share, would not be used for running costs. So there's a tension there, isn't there? And we need to find a solution. In Manchester, they've got the airport, so they've had money through that. Their combined authority is a subscription plus a precept. And Andy Byrne introduced a precept this year, and I tried to introduce a precept. And I know I went to the Labour groups, all the ones that I could get into. I went to the Labour groups to explain what this meant. And it's not an easy political argument, is it, to say to people who have been hit really, really hard that they would have to find an additional sum of money to fund the combined authority. But unless we understand what the combined authority does, and I get the counter argument that unless we are able to demonstrate what it is that we do, it's very difficult to ask people to pay into it. But once they realise what it is that we're doing, they'd be more likely to pay into it. So I wanted to introduce a precept which was £12 on a Van D property, £1 a month for an average family. And that was because what we need to do is not just to run the combined authority, but to build the capacity so that we can develop pipeline projects for when those funding streams become available to us. We need oven-ready projects. That's why we've been unsuccessful. We haven't had oven-ready projects. All we've had is ideas. Give us some money, we'll be able to develop that. Other areas with capacity, they've had big chunks of money because they've developed. So that's where we need to get to. And I think a precept is probably one of the models that we need to re-explore. The local authorities have agreed to the budget for this year. But you're right, it's about sustainability. And I think either it will be through a subscription model, a precept, which I think is much more equitable and fair. And actually, as the Metro Mayor, I'll take some stick for it, won't I? Because it would be me having to stand up and say, this is what we're spending your money on. It's a difficult one. Andy Byrne's done it, to tell you the truth. People have primarily accepted it in Manchester, but really little political fallout behind. Or it'll be a hybrid of either that sort of levying or precepting the councils rather than the individual council taxpayers. But if we want something to work, it always has to be paid for, doesn't it? You never get anything for nothing. The money that we get, the 30 million quid, what we can now do is demonstrate just how much that has enabled us to leave other parts of money. We can demonstrate that we've had over £500 million of investments because we have devolution, £500 million. You think about how hard councils have been hit, and then we're getting some money through this machinery of the combined authority. We just need to win the battle really outside to persuade people that what it is that we're doing is worthy of them having to pay a little bit more, but they will get a lot more back.
Okay, can I just say thank you very much. Unless we have any more questions from members? No? I think they've grilled you, to be fair, and I think you've done an incredible job answering the questions in detail, which is fantastic. Thank you very, very much for your help. Thank you very much for the information you provided. Thank you very much also for the support that you've given this committee over our first year. We look forward to working with you moving forward. Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Okay, thank you very much everybody. Thank you members for the questions to the Metro Mayor. I think that was a really, really well undertaken agenda item. if we can go back to our agenda and if we can pick up that at agenda item 6, which is the report of reviewed quality across the city region. We're tabling the drafted report for the task and finish group. I have to say, as a member of that task and finish group, I was very, very proud of the work that the committee members actually did, and also very proud of the work that the council officers did in support of that committee, and also to thank the people that we gave that came to provide evidence. I mean, our experts. I think at one point we had more experts than SoftMIC, whoever SoftMIC was, but I think that was really, really good, and it actually allowed us to understand how important quality is currently and how it's going to be of increasing importance moving forward, and should be something that the Liverpool City Region identify with and actually champion. The recommendations from the report lead a number of proposals with regard to the Liverpool City Region and what they can do as the combined authority. One of the key points is that a lot of the legislation actually relies at local council level and isn't something the Liverpool City Region takes responsibility for. They can and should have a leading role in that. Do members have any questions or comments on the drafted report before us? Councillor
O'Brien.
O'Brien, yeah.
I'd like to praise the report for having been on the task and finish. I think it's excellent. I really applaud all the appendices that were included. I thought they were important after we had such a lot of experts advising us. And personally, it was a bit of a shock to me to realise how much our health is affected, principally by diesel cars. But I'd also urge the committee to really press for the recommendations to go through and for us to pressurise our local authorities to get something done, because this will make the Liverpool City region a much more attractive area. Environmental concerns are very important now in the public eye. Thank you.
Any other comments or questions on this particular? Can I ask that we, as every recommendations is set out on page 17, I recognise that we will have to convert by email. However, if we can have a draft recommendation, that would be very, very good. Yeah. Fantastic, thank you very, very much. Okay, agenda item 7 is a report of review into welfare reform. This was our third task and finish group. It was one I wasn't actually personally involved with. I think from the discussions that we've had, the questions that have been raised, certainly from Councillor Brennan and Councillor Wainwright to the Metro Mayor this afternoon, this morning, it is going to be an incredibly contentious issue, and I think that we're right to draw attention to that. I don't know, Councillor Wainwright, if you want to comment on this.
Just to say to you, I was due to ask it changes. Sanctions for no apparent reasons, I think it's racist. So I'd like to thank all members of the party. Again, I'd like to thank those evidence who came from the evidence, especially Nick Aiken, the Halton Housing Trust. Excellent presentation from him, excellent presentations from other people as well. Nitesh Patel from the CAB, special love to him because he has to deal. As the CEO of the CAB, he has to deal with many, many cases resulting from this terrible mix
Sullivan, do you members have any questions or comments? Councillor Sullivan, I know you led.
Just one comment I'd like to make. It's an excellent report. It was an excellent piece of work. But what Halton are doing, I think, and part of the recommendation should be what Halton are doing, particularly the Housing Trust there. They're doing fantastic work, and I think one of our recommendations should be to look at the Halton model, because Universal Credit was piloted there 18 months ago now. But the work that's being done there, particularly by the Housing Association and the local council, I would say all the other 5 boroughs should look in detail at what Halton are doing. Thanks, Chair.
Okay.
You're doing fantastic work.
Thank you very much. Do we have any other comments or questions on this particular report? Can I turn to the officers with regard to Councillor Sullivan's point about modification to those recommendations?
Yes, Chair, we can ensure that's added in terms of the version that's circulated to the full committee. There are already some networks in place, both between the housing associations and between the councils as well. And perhaps what you might want to recommend is enhancing those networks, ensuring that those will be shared more widely.
Highlighting them. Thanks, Chair.
I will move that further recommendation.
Okay. Can we have that seconded? Okay. So if we can make a note of that recommendation and make the modification to the report. Thank you very much. With that modification agreed, can we agree the recommendations as set out on page 47?
Agreed.
Okay. And that brings us to agenda item 8, which is the Scrutiny Annual Report 2017-2018, and that's page 61 of our notes. Okay. And this report represents the draft Scrutiny Annual Report 2017-18. The report provides a summary of the work undertaken by the committee, and each of our task and finishing groups. And I have to say, I've sat on a number of scrutiny committees, that I think the way that this scrutiny committee has moved forward with the work and identified the areas to set up the task and finish groups is something to be commended. I think the work that's been undertaken by the members of the committee should be recognised. Certainly the amount of information I've learnt, and I would hope that the rest of the committee will learn from the spatial development strategy, from the air pollution, and obviously, as we've talked about already, welfare reform. I think that's what good scrutiny is about. I was very, very pleased when the Metro Mayor today recognised the work that this scrutiny committee is doing. It's been our first year. I think there are obviously areas of improvement. There are always areas of improvement. One of the things that I would pick up is a point that Councillor Sullivan made earlier, and I think this is a point that Councillor Wainwright then subsequently highlighted, which is issues with regard to attendance. And I would like to pick up Councillor Wainwright's recommendation that the two vice chairs meet with myself and with our senior officers to actually take that forward to the constituent council leaders and draw their attention to that. I think, you know, that would be a piece of work we should do. But outside of that, you know, I feel very proud of the work of the committee and the support. I would like to thank the officers for the support that they've actually provided to us, both with regard to the meetings themselves, but one of the things that we have had is background information, and I think background information is incredibly useful, especially when we're looking at our task and finishes group. So I would like to thank all of our officers that have supported the committee over the year. It has been my absolute private privilege, and I feel incredibly honoured to have been able to chair this committee meeting. You know, and I would like to thank the members, particularly the support that they've given me as chair. You know, you're not always the easiest group of people to corral.
You've done very well. You've done really well.
Thank you very much. But, you know, it has been, and I've been so proud to do it, and to have my name on the reports is something that, you know, I'll take forward. I am standing down, as I've done 12 years as a councillor. This is my last meeting as chair of the scrutiny and review panel for the full city region. And I would say I've learned so much, and it has been an honour and a privilege to work with you all. So thank you very much, and good luck for going forward.
Thank you.
that's our animal report, apart from that castaway and I go my balloon. Pop my balloon off.
Just to echo your sentiments with regards to the officers, thank you on behalf of the members for your comments regarding us, and to thank you for doing the job.
Thank you very much. Excellent. Good. Okay, so I'll see you all down the pool in about 15 minutes. Right, we haven't got any questions or any comments, we've dealt with those. Can we agree the recommendations as set out on page 61? This is where I will report.
Agreed.
Excellent. Thank you very, very much. I've not been informed of any urgent items, and this is the last of the meetings for this community here. But don't forget, we have got a meeting, a special meeting set up next week, which will give us the opportunity to look at the budget process, which I think is something that we should actually value. So I would hope to see as many members as possible at that.
I have to give my apologies because I'm actually working on it. And it's just such a shame because I asked
But hopefully, if you have any questions and the documents will be shared with you. You know, I would like to just put on record, it's a private meeting, it's a meeting for the members to understand how the budget process works to help us in our role of scrutiny moving forward. Okay, thank you very much, everybody.
Thank you.
Good luck.